you have more people that have more devices in places like Australia, Singapore, New Zealand, as well as Malaysia. But that will definitely increase in the near future. More and more people will have more devices. And more people would want to connect their different devices to mobile data or internet. This is from another study that we published earlier this year in terms of what are the benefits of having data shared bundle. Because when customers have more devices, definitely they want to be able to connect different devices to the internet. So for the customer perspective, I don't want to have one package or plan for one device and another package for another device. I want to be able to share my quota with the different devices. Imagine if I have a 5G package, I want to be able to share it with my smartphone, I want to be able to share it with my laptop as well as tablet. Or it could be from a family perspective. I could have two kids that only wants to use their own smartphone. So if I subscribe to a 10 gig plan, maybe I can share it with my wife, with my kids, or even with my parents. So more and more customers are interested in data shared plans. Because the benefit for them, of course, the key benefit for them is to save money by bundling, to have one data plan for all the devices, and to have a single bill for the family. Those are the top three. And of course, they want to have a shared allowance with the family. Because if you, let's say, have a 10 gig plan, maybe you want to control for your son, they can only use 500 MB per month. So you can consume the rest. So this is becoming more popular. You see operators worldwide introducing this to their customers. I don't think it's offered yet in the Philippines, but this could be an interesting proposition for consumers here in the Philippines as well. To allow the customer to be able to share their data quota. Of course, this can work for consumers. This can also work for the enterprise as well. Because imagine a company being able to share data plan among its employees. So this could be one of the possibilities that can be offered by operators here in the Philippines. Moving on, now we look at connected services. We ask the consumers in Philippines and in other markets about interest and usage on three services. The first one is connected me, basically using wearable technologies such as fitbits and smartwatches. We also ask the consumer about connected car, connecting your car to other devices to download apps, access online services, or control features on your car from your phone. We also ask about connected home, connecting your home to devices or the internet. For example, to control the temperature, or lighting, or to play music. As we can see from a regional perspective, the interest is quite high, but usage today in our region is still relatively low. But there's a lot of opportunity. Consumers are interested in having the different connected services. The connected me, the connected car, as well as the connected home. If you look at country by country perspective, of course, in most countries throughout the region, the usage is still relatively low. The red bar is used, the yellow bar is interested. You can see that across all the regional countries, including the Philippines, the usage is still low, but the interest will be much, much higher. So we just need the right device, the right pricing, then more and more customers will actually be using the service. If we look at the Philippine number, when it comes to connected me, 8% are using it today. Connected home, 12% are using it today. And when it comes to connected car, 7% are using it today. But when you look at the interest is somewhere between 29% and 36%. So at least one third would actually embrace these different services. Any one of you are using Fitbit in this room? So it's already happening. And I think when it comes to connected home, people ask, why do you want to connect your home? I think it's more about security concerns. It could be you are concerned about your home, or you're concerned about your kids. You might leave your kids at home with somebody to take care. So from time to time, you want to take care, to look at your home or even your kids. So those are the factors that would be driving usage. Now, this is already happening. And this is, for the very first time, we actually start to release the number when it comes to connected devices. This is our projection when it comes to connected devices. So, of course, we believe that in 2014, we have 13.5 billion connected devices. We project that by 2020, there will be 26 billion connected devices. So we have the vision of 50 billion connected devices, and we believe that we are on the way to reaching that ambition or vision. And of course, when it comes to the 26 billion connected devices, these are not inclusive of passive sensors and RFID tags. If we were to include those numbers, the numbers would be even bigger. So today, it's 13.5 billion. We will go to 26 billion by 2020. This is the first time we are showing numbers when it comes to connected devices. So that was on connected devices. Now we look at network performance. How do you make sure that the customer enjoys the best experience? So we use data from Ookla. We did an analysis to compare the median speed, the top 10% speed, the bottom 10% speed for the different countries in the region. So if we look at the median download speed, where 50% of the people that have the app will enjoy that speed, we can see that when it comes to median download throughput speed in KBTS, Singapore and Australia are in the lead. Philippines is ahead of Vietnam, but is behind Indonesia and Malaysia and the other countries. When it comes to peak downlink throughput, this is for the top 10% in different countries. We can see that Singapore and Australia continue to be in the lead, but from the top 10%, Philippines is ahead of Indonesia and Vietnam, but behind of Malaysia, Thailand, Australia and Singapore. So that's two perspectives. Another perspective is the bottom 10%. This is the worst speed that you can experience in the country for the bottom 10%. We call it cell edge. So you have 20% probability of getting the speed. So if we look at bottom 10% perspective, Australia and Singapore continue to be the lead. But Philippines is slightly ahead of Malaysia and Vietnam, but behind Indonesia and Thailand. But of course, there's a lot of different factors that influence this result. The smartphone or the devices that you have in the market will play a role. The screen size, the quality of the device, the high-end quality versus low-end quality will deliver different performance. And of course, the policy implemented by the different players play a role. The fair usage policy, because what happens after you reach 5G, your full data quota? Does the operator throttle it or stop your service? So those are the factors that could influence. But our key message or implication from this is that we look at different apps requiring different technical quality. If you look at HD video streaming, it will require 2000 kbps. It will require 2000 kbps downlink. When it comes to video streaming, 720 kbps downlink. Video telephony, 600 kbps. Music streaming, 160, and voice 12.5. If you look at today, you can see that Singapore and Australia have, for the bottom 10%, still good experience for video streaming. But if you look at the other countries, there's still a lot of room for improvement. And of course, we know that operators in Philippines continues to improve the network, but there's still a lot of things that can improve in order to deliver the best experience when it comes to video, when it comes to music, and when it comes to other apps. Because we've seen this now, more and more customers are using video on their mobile phones, and we see that by 2020, 60% of the data traffic would actually be coming from video. So when more and more customers are using video, of course, it's obvious that we need to deliver the best experience for the users as well. this one of the articles that we also published in the main report, looking at big sporting events. We look at the last World Football Championship in Brazil in 2014. Remember last year we had the World Championship in Brazil. So we look at what happened when we have big sporting events. We noticed that we basically interviewed 800 people that attended the events in Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro. After they exited the stadium, we basically talked to them, see what do they use during the events and what are their experience. We see that when we do big sporting events, we look at different types of smartphone usage. So from high data usage, things such as posted or sent a video and watch a video on the internet, medium access a social network, post or send a video picture, and then use the internet to find content related to the event. And of course, low in terms of using instant messaging, instead of making and receiving voice calls, as well as sending and receiving text messages. So of course, most people are doing different activities, medium as well as low, but then you do have people that are using high data usage apps as well. Is that by 2020, we will have about 9.2 million mobile subscriptions. And when it comes to mobile broadband, it will be 7.7 billion, which is about 85%. And we will have more than two times smartphone subscription. And 70% of world population will have a smartphone. And we said also just now that 90% of those age 6 years and above will have a mobile phone. And of course, video will continue to grow. It will grow 9 times from 2014. And of course, we can expect bigger coverage when it comes to 3G and SSPA. And we can expect better coverage as well when it comes to LTE. So that was my last slide. I'm now passing.